This is Babcock Ranch, a community of homes in Southwest Florida that runs almost entirely on solar power.
One of the nicknames that a lot of people refer this place as the bubble, because we're kind of in our own environment here. With the solar field here, there's a lot less dependence on fossil fuel power.
One of the things that we've done well here in Florida is it's accepted that you can build these utility scale solar arrays, and I think that's great. Everybody is welcoming the opportunity to put solar on their property.
Kitson founded Babcock Ranch in 2006 with one goal.
We wanted to prove that we could do this the right way, prove that we could build this new city and work with the environment and make it not only sustainable, but resilient.
What I think is happening in Florida, there has been this industrial boom over the past decade. So with more industry comes more power demand. And utilities need to think about the most affordable way to provide that power to their ratepayers. So the economics are there for solar.
Today, solar makes up roughly 9% of Florida's electricity mix, a big leap for a state once seen as slow to adopt renewables.
People have realized that solar is cheap. It, along with onshore wind. Wind and solar are the cheapest forms of new electricity worldwide and in the United States today, whether subsidized or not. So because of the low cost, but also due to the additional subsidies and policies that are less restrictive now than they used to be in Florida, solar has started to grow.
Still, this boom is happening in a state that in 2024 removed climate change from its official energy and resilience plans, while still relying on natural gas for 74% of its power. And now the One Big Beautiful Bill is phasing out federal tax credits for rooftop and utility scale solar earlier than planned, raising costs for developers and homeowners alike.
That is one of the biggest challenges that we're seeing, and there is a high anti-renewables or anti-climate change sentiment, so that could drive a lot of the potential community opposition in the near future.
At Babcock Ranch, these tensions come into focus. A town trying to prove a new energy model can work, even in one of America's toughest states for climate policy. So CNBC visited Babcock Ranch to understand how Florida quietly became a solar superpower. Texas added the most utility-scale solar capacity in 2024, fueled by cheap land, lax regulations, and rising energy demand from AI and data centers. But Florida is catching up. In 2024, it overtook California in new utility-scale solar capacity, adding over 3 gigawatts, enough to power around 600,000 homes. And it's not just Florida. Arkansas, Missouri, Louisiana, and other southern states are seeing explosive growth, too.
Texas is going full force, fortunately, with renewables of wind and solar and batteries. And this is helping also to keep the grid stable in Texas. So Florida can learn from Texas as well as from California in growing both solar and batteries.
Florida's rise as a solar powerhouse isn't just about the sun. A special rule there lets solar farms under 75 megawatts skip lengthy state-level reviews, speeding up projects and lowering costs. In 2024, the surge was led by Florida's main utility company, Florida Power & Light, which built over 70% of the state's new solar capacity.
People might not understand how progressive Florida is in this realm, if you will, of solar energy. And as you know, we compete extremely well with states like California, and we're very proud of that.
California still leads the nation in overall solar power generation. The state has more than 2 million rooftop systems installed over time, thanks to decades of strong policy and net metering. In contrast, Florida has seen about 260,000 rooftop installs to date. And most of its solar growth has come from utility-owned, large-scale projects.
All of the capacity is being owned by utilities. They are the only ones that are allowed to connect with the ratepayers in order to connect solar or bring solar online. So it has been like self-initiative from these utilities.
The Inflation Reduction Act helped, offering a 30% tax credit for large-scale solar. But Florida's flagship solar town, Babcock Ranch, did it without government incentives. Privately funded, the town set out to prove clean development could be both smart and self-sustaining. And when Hurricane Ian slammed Southwest Florida in 2022, Babcock Ranch stayed fully powered while millions lost electricity. Residents like Don Bishop said that this is a big plus of living here.
We've been through several of the major hurricanes. Ian sat over our houses for 8 hours, and nobody lost power, didn't lose internet, didn't lose water. So it's very comforting if you've ever had to experience a hurricane in the south in the summertime and lose those things.
More than a decade ago, Babcock Ranch built its first 150 megawatt solar system when utility scale solar was rare in the U.S.
When we decided to become their first solar powered town, there just weren't a lot of these utility scale solar arrays anywhere, not just here in Florida, but around the country. So when we actually built the system here at Babcock Ranch, and we had 150 megawatts, you know, I was hoping that that would kind of set a precedent. And oh my gosh, did it set a precedent, because they're doing solar all over the state of Florida now. And it's thrilling to see that. At the time we started, natural gas was very inexpensive. So compared to natural gas, solar energy was more expensive. But then over the next, say, 5-6 years, the price of solar went down significantly, the price of natural gas went up, and there was this equilibrium that we now had. And that's what made it so work for us, was that we now had a renewable source of energy that competed directly from a cost perspective to natural gas, and it just opened the door for us to be able to go forward.
Florida has also ranked number 2 behind California for the most rooftop residential solar panels installed each year, from 2019 through 2024.
Homeowners are compensated for their exported energy at the same rate that they pay for the electricity that they consume. So most Florida utilities do offer this, you can think of it as a one-to-one compensation.
But big challenges remain, and Florida still depends heavily on natural gas for about 74% of its electricity.
There is opportunity for growth, but there are also risks there. It's just going to increase, and the easiest, most affordable way to meet that demand is with solar, and utilities know it.
At the federal level, the One Big Beautiful Bill, recently signed into law in 2025 by President Trump, accelerates the phase-out of solar and wind tax credits originally set to run through 2032. For homeowners, the bill eliminates key solar incentives after 2025. For utility-scale developers, it shortens the construction window for qualifying projects and imposes tougher sourcing and service requirements. Though pitched as a way to simplify the system, the law effectively cuts support early and raises costs, creating new hurdles for future solar growth.
The early expiration of the tax credits with the One Big Beautiful Bill Act that was just passed on July 4th. So this effectively reduces the tax credits that are available for solar and wind assets. So economics turn a bit more challenging. Still, it's still favorable, like solar is still profitable without the tax credits, but still it's just easier to make the economics work when the tax credits are in place.
On top of that, homeowners still face policy risks. In 2022, lawmakers nearly ended net metering, the policy allowing homeowners to sell extra power back to the grid, before massive public backlash forced a veto.
Florida, as of 2024, was the second ranked residential solar state, and it actually has been ranked second from 2019 all the way through 2024. There's a significant amount of untapped potential.
Adding so much solar has forced Florida to update its grid. Utilities have been forced to invest heavily in storage and smart systems to handle sharp peaks and dips in generation.
The main driver for steady growth within Florida is the special permitting for plants that are lower than 75 megawatts in power. But if there is increased community opposition and local, then that could jeopardize many of these facilities.
Meanwhile, advanced technologies like microgrids and local energy systems are being tested to improve resilience and reduce long-term costs.
Part of the issue with a microgrid, the technology is there, it's the cost per kilowatt hour. So we're going to work through that, and hopefully within a couple of years we're going to be able to use that data and share it with others to say, hey, look, here's the way it can work, not only for the environment, but it can work economically for the people who live there.
Some expect solar to continue to grow, with or without incentives.
We expect the provisions in the One Big Beautiful Bill Act to impact the residential solar market significantly. The primary impact, at least in the near term, is from the elimination of the customer-owned investment tax credit after 2025, which will make solar less affordable for customers. So while this bill could result in as much as a 42% decline to our 5-year residential solar outlook compared to our business as usual base case, We do expect the residential solar market to eventually return to growth in the next few years, but potentially at a smaller scale than previously expected.
For Kitson, this could offer insights for other states navigating grid reliability and clean energy goals.
I hope that California, other states will really take the lessons learned at Babcock Ranch and maybe incorporate that into what they're doing. And what we'd like to see is not only for people to take a look at our playbook, but then to do it better, to improve on what we're doing and just take it even to another level, although we're going to continue to try and do that here. When you look at, for example, the first solar to battery facility that we have here, having that as a backup has been very, very helpful.
And now to push resilience even farther, Babcock Ranch is trying to test microgrids and new backup systems designed to handle extreme weather and grid disruptions.
For us to lose power, there has to be truly something catastrophic. But again, we have a redundant source of energy that makes it work. The other thing we're exploring right now are these microgrids. And we're working with Florida Power and Light to take a neighborhood, and we're, for example, Innovation 2.0 that we're going to be doing, where we're building these homes that are going to be so unique. And we're right now working with them to put in a microgrid and see how that works. Part of the issue with a microgrid, the technology is there, it's the cost per kilowatt hour. So we're going to work through that, and hopefully within a couple of years we're going to be able to use that data and share it with others.
Florida has plenty of resources. It has the potential. The main barriers are not technical or economic to transition Florida to entirely clean renewable energy, reducing people's costs and creating jobs. They are social and political.